What about those Old Testament verses that seem really harsh? Like the one in Deuteronomy where God condemns a rebellious child to be stoned to death. I've got gay friends and they point out the fact that we don't obey that one. So why should we accept the verse in Leviticus where it condemns homosexuality?
It's true, there's a passage that says if children are disobedient, they should be put to death. And I mean, no one interprets that literally.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm saying is, if the church no longer interprets that literally, maybe homosexuality is also on that list.
Maybe.
I think it's because we don't understand that in the Jewish culture the idea of punishment was based on a principle called measure for measure. So we recognize an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. We think about that as a motto, but we don't really think about what it means. What it means is that if I lose my eye because you've harmed me, I'm not entitled to take both of your eyes. In other words, it's tort reform in Hebrew terms, right? It says that the maximum amount that I'm allowed to seek as a remuneration is the equivalent for what I've lost. So there's no such thing as punitive damages in Hebrew law. If I lose an eye as a result of your actions, the maximum, not the minimum, the maximum that I can take is your eye. What's the minimum? Forgiveness. The minimum is what Jesus does in John chapter 8. The maximum was stoning for the woman caught in adultery. The minimum is forgiveness. Okay? So when we read a rebellious child should be stoned, we're reading about the maximum, the very worst case. In the very worst case, when a child in the Hebrew, and remember it's about community, when a child in the Hebrew community continues to resist, is deliberately disobedient, is unfaithful, shows no sign of recognizing the God's commandment toward honor toward parents. And by the way, that's very destructive to the community because it opens the door for all other kinds of action. When the elders of the community reach the decision that this child is at the absolute maximum, then we see the penalty. But what's the minimum? The minimum is forgiveness, restoration. In our view, it would be the minimum is counseling, intervention. It's, you know, helping this child. We don't have to read about that because the Hebrew community clearly understood that that was all there. The only thing that the commandment gives is the maximum.
Many Old Testament laws were ceremonial. They pointed to Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, for example, or they modeled aspects of Israel's unique calling as God's people relative to other pagan nations. But now that we're in the New Covenant, on the other side of Christ's sacrifice, resurrection, and enthronement, we no longer offer up animals ceremonially, their blood for the atonement for sin. Jesus has done that. And because there's no longer any redemptive distinction between Jew and Gentile, every tribe and tongue under heaven has been offered salvation through Christ. We're no longer concerned about ceremonial laws that symbolized ethnic Israel as God's own unique, peculiar people. So things like mixing cotton and wool and not rounding the corners of your beard, shaving, are no longer wrong. But as for the moral laws, things that, for example, deal with rebellion, lying, theft, sexual behavior, etc., if they were wrong in the Old Testament, then they may remain wrong today and forever. The penal sanctions for these sins against God and also their crimes against human society may or may not be the same. That's a whole other issue we don't have time to go into right now. But they very much remain sins, violations of God's moral order. So rebellion remains wrong, and so do all forms of sexual activity outside of the male-female covenantal union that God calls marriage. So fornication, adultery, and yes, all forms of homosexual sexuality are sinful acts. They're just wrong.